All right, thank you, Dr. Chiappetta. Our next presenter is Dino Pinciotti. Dino is the director of our rehabilitation here at UOA, and he's going to be talking to us about some considerations for spinal rehab.
I'm good. Okay, being a physical therapist, I think we all should stand up just for a second, okay? Everybody stand up, because sitting is the new smoking, okay? Everybody at work that sits too much, need a stretch? Okay, good. Excellent. A little backward extension. All right, go ahead and sit back down. I want to thank Eric for putting this together. Thank all of you for coming out this morning. I've been a physical therapist for over 31 years, been in the area for a long time, know many of the trainers out here. So I wanted to kind of keep this concise as far as chunking it out for different types of diagnosis for your back patients. This is kind of specific for athletes as well as the lumbar spine, because I didn't have time in a 20-minute lecture to get into the cervical spine. So I have no disclosures. I'm going to kind of just go through some of the objectives, you know, be able to define the term core. You know, Dr. Chiappetta talked about core stabilization. I think if that's one of the takeaways you take away from today, is that's the quintessential important thing that your athletes should be doing with their rehab. And again, if you have a weak core, it lends itself to having other problems in your upper extremity, your lower extremity. There's been reports about people that have weak core then, you know, injuring their knee because they don't have the strong core muscles. So that's something that we're going to really talk about, be able to describe and understand the difference between microtrauma and macrotrauma with athletes. Understand the component of functional approach to kinetic chain rehab, including core that affects the lower and upper extremity, and how the core functions to maintain posture alignment and achieve dynamic stability during all functional movements in athletes. And I want to also have you leave with an understanding of the functional progression and sequencing of how we take an athlete who comes into the training room or comes into the PT office with back pain. And he might just come with a script that just says back pain. When I have an opportunity to lecture to some of the orthopedic residents, I always kind of say, you know, back pain is not a diagnosis, right? Back pain is a symptom. So try to get that definitive diagnosis from the referring doctor. If you can't, then obviously you have to do your best clinical evaluation to come up with that. I wanted to spend a few minutes on some red flags. So again, signs and symptoms found in the patient history and clinical examination that might tie to a disorder of serious pathology. In everyone's career, you find a patient or an athlete who has back pain, and then it lends itself to something else, something more serious. So if they're not getting better with what you're doing, that should be a red flag to refer them out to a surgeon or to a doctor. Sometimes this is identified as a finding that is reflective of delayed or poor outcome. We call this prognostic red flag. So here's some of the red flags we're going to go through. I'm not going to go through each one of these. You guys can see them up there. But again, multiple myeloma, Dr. Chiappetta referred to, Dr. McDonald referred to, you know, different types of things, lymphoma, spinal cord, neoplasm, infection, anti-inflammatory arthritis. These are all things that can be non-traditional musculoskeletal diagnoses that need to be addressed by someone outside our scope of practice. GI, pancreatitis, scoliositis. Again, these are things that might be things to consider. Again, good history taking during the initial eval is extremely important. Sometimes you can find these things out. Again, sometimes we don't find them out until we've tried a couple weeks of rehab, and the patient is just not progressing like you'd like them to. So again, some of the clinical guidelines. In the audience here, we have physicians, PTs, athletic trainers. We'll talk briefly about macro trauma. So the high velocity injuries in a single event. So this could happen during a soccer event here down at the bottom, where it's a inability to generate sufficient core stability to resist external forces during high speed events. You know, football, soccer, ice hockey. And these usually result in these result in your muscle tears, strains, sprains, ligament injuries, and bony fragments. Again, I agree with Dr. Chiappetta that this is a high volume of what you're going to see in the high school, middle school, even in college athletes. Then we have our repetitive low-level forces for overuse. This is deficient endurance in the core stabilizing muscles, postural syndromes. This is where you get into the spondylosis, spondylolisthesis, and disc injuries. So I want to just kind of break down sort of a classification that we're now using in field of PT to look at some of these different spinal injuries. I'm going to leave out number four because I know a lot of athletic trainers, and even we don't even have it here at this office, is lumbar traction. So we don't even go into that. But we're going to go through each one of these and kind of chunk it out. And these are the three ways that I think you should be thinking about that athlete or that patient's rehab. So specific exercises, centralization. These are exercises that centralizes, reduces symptoms, or addresses the patient's condition specifically, often referred to as MDT approach, or the mechanical diagnosis and treatment approach, made popular by McKenzie. So McKenzie's approach was, we need to work on extension to try and centralize the pain out of the leg and into the low back. So if an athlete has radicular symptoms, you're probably going to try and take a little bit of more of a McKenzie approach. Things like, you know, prone on elbows, prone press-ups. We use the Swiss ball a lot once we've got them working to higher levels, and I'll kind of go through that. So the mobilization, again, techniques that people have gone to extended continuing education courses, again, whether it's in your scope of practice or not, working on thrust and non-thrust manipulation, mobilization with movement, muscle energy techniques. Those are all things that this group of people need. They need to be mobilized because they're either stiff or they're locked up in the lumbar spine. Then we have our immobilization. There's no decrease in their symptoms with any movement. So this is the group that we're going to work on with stabilization and strengthening. And we call them local and non-specific strengthening exercises. We start with the local ones, and then we work out to more bigger movements and trying to get a general activation of the core with these. So again, down at the bottom, just some series of different exercises. Again, if you're in a high school setting, if people are pretty fit, you know, in this environment, we see the gamut. We see Medicare patients, we see active, you know, over 30 individuals, and we see high school, middle school athletes as well. So just kind of knowing where you're going to start that program with that athlete based on how you find in your evaluation. So one thing I wanted to spend a few seconds on is something referred to as a lateral shift. Lateral shift does not automatically, Porter and Miller in 1985 said it doesn't automatically incomplete a disc pathology. To correct that lateral shift, you look for centralization of their symptoms. And I'll show you a couple pictures of what that would look like. And then Wernicke and Hart in 1999 and then again in 2001 showed that centralization has been shown to be an effective treatment for positive outcomes in multiple studies. You want to have carryover with their home exercise and follow-up treatment sessions. So again, doing standing lateral side glides as well as working on prone on elbows and prone press-ups. So this is an example of someone who came into the office with a lateral shift. This is the manual technique that we would do, and then this is part of their extended home program that we would have them doing at home to correct that lateral shift. The key is once you've corrected that, then working on core strengthening to keep that in place so that they don't then have that lateral shift again. So the mobilization classification, so we have this clinical prediction rule called CPR. So the duration of symptoms, greater than 16 days, hip internal rotations, of at least 35 degrees, lumbar sigmoid hypomobility testing with the spring test. No symptoms are distal to the knee. Their score is less than 19 on the fear avoidance beliefs questionnaire. And so if you have Flynn and his group, if you had four or five of these findings, then the odds are short-term positive response for manipulation by 25-fold and demonstrated better outcomes with exercises. So the stabilization group, again, is there a need for this clinical prediction rule? We think there is. We want to make sure that these types of patients have an average of a straight leg raise greater than 91 degrees. They have a positive prone instability test, and then they have this positive aberrant movements, which is, again, altered movement as you go through your evaluation. They have catching, or they have spasm, or they have any kind of painful arc of motion. And again, these are usually under the age of 40. So the stabilization group, again, the key here is working on the transverse abdominis and the multifidi. So we're going to kind of talk a little bit about how we're going to do that, and it's a multi-phased approach. So why are we focusing on the core with athletes? Again, there's a great number of studies done talking about how the relationship to function and ADLs, and as well as sports. So Naught and Voss, way back in 68, talked about proximal stability for distal mobility. I mean, that's pretty true for athletes. They got to have that strong proximal muscles before they can do anything, you know, away from their body. Kinetic chain relationships, Ben Kibler down in Kentucky brought this up, and then the importance of normals or the uninjured for sports performance, speed, and power. So that's why the core is so important. So just again, some examples how in sports, you know, you have a professional baseball pitcher here, from the ground to the upper lower extremities, through the trunk, through the upper extremity to throw the ball for velocity, location, rotation of the ball, delivery of different types of pitches. With the gymnast, forces from the apparatus to the upper extremities through the trunk to propel the body airborne positions like they're doing here on the vault. Again, conversion of horizontal energy to vertical speed, position, trajectory of the body through space. Again, as Dr. Chiappetta referred to, there's, you know, gymnasts are highly incidence of lower back pain. Tennis, again, similar thing like baseball, where the ground from the lower extremities through the trunk, through the upper extremities, through the racket to hit the ball, to have velocity, location, spin, and different types of serves. So this is some of the different diagnoses that you can have if you have a weak core. It affects the knee, the patellofemoral joint, affects the shoulder, rotator cuff, scapular thoracic dysfunction, and then all your other, you know, low back diagnoses that were talked about earlier today. So again, let's talk a little bit about the core muscles. Again, you're going to stabilize the body segment so another segment can be generated power. Again, going back to this concept of proximal stability for distal mobility. The core acts as a shock absorption for the body, maintains functional postures, and then this dynamic motion to accomplish by the core musculature. So in the trunk and the pelvis, plenty of these injuries in these areas are a result of overuse, muscle imbalances, poor biomechanical dysfunction, complex rotational movement patterns with the athlete, that axial twisting, i.e. golf, gymnastics. You know, that's what really creates havoc on our spine, is that rotation. Can be very destructive, and for some people, this lumbar pelvic hip complex, you get this torque conversion, which sometimes actually ends the person's playing career. Axial twist motions, again, these are things that really can create havoc on our spine. Co-contraction of rectus abdominis, the rectus spine and muscles, despite their limited potential to generate twisting motions. Athletic activities, the power really is generated from the hips and the stable trunk. So Barb Hoogenboom out in Michigan coined the phrase, the butt and the gut. So again, do a lot of hip strengthening, gluteus medius, gluteus maximus, and as well as working on the core, they kind of work together. So again, your evaluation is critical to see if there's weaknesses, doing specific muscle testing to see if there's weaknesses on one side or the other when it comes to the hips. So spinal stabilization, again, it's what the athletes need to have in their lumbar spine when they're performing their activities. Rotational forces in the lumbar spine are destructive to the athlete, again, can cause severe problems, and can even end an athlete's career. So again, what we're trying to do here is stabilize the spine by working the transverse abdominis, the multifidi, and thinking that as a unit. So we're getting this co-contraction of muscles. hip musculature can protect and improve performance. So the lower back pain, pelvic, hip, and lower extremity injuries demonstrate tightness of the hip flexors and weakness of the gluteus maximus, posterior fibers of the gluteus medius, and the deep external rotators. Watkins and his group demonstrated the importance of trunk and hip muscles in stabilizing and controlling loading the response for maximal power and accuracy with golfers. So this is what we're looking at here when we're talking about this relationship of the transverse abdominis, the multifidi and how it creates this ability to stabilize the lumbar spine. So we need these. It also works with the diaphragm and the pelvic floor too to create this, you know, sort of cage look. We need to incorporate these programs in, with all exercises. So again, talking about previously about local muscles and then global muscles. So the local muscles, they're your postural, tonic, and segmental stabilizers. So we have your multifidi, transverse abdominis, quadratus lumborum, diaphragm. These down here are kind of debatable whether they're more global or more local, your hip rotators and hip abductors. You got your global muscles over here, your obliques, latissimus dorsi, hip adductors, hip extensors, quad, hamstrings. So Richards and Joel, they talked about this in 2004, that we try to break down these different muscles and what their function is. So one of the things we do here in the office, and it can be done, you know, very easily with a blood pressure cuff or with this thing called a stabilizer. Again, it does the same thing as a blood pressure cuff. Put it to like 40 millimeters of mercury, put it in their lumbar spine, and then you're asking them to activate that and try to keep that anywhere between, let's say, 40 and 45 millimeters of mercury. You're not trying to get them to, like, you know, push down on it so hard that that pressure goes up to 100. And it takes sometimes, you know, it's interesting in the office. I've started doing this years ago, but it's amazing how patients really don't get that sense of what that, you know, tightening that transverse abdominis really should feel like. So this gives them some great feedback while they're looking at that dial, while they're laying on their back. And they can also do it prone and put it on their stomach and see if they can do that same tightening of the transverse abdominis. So this has been a very kind of an effective tool to try and get people when they're in the acute stages to understand what that means. And then we build upon those exercises. So the transverse abdominis, because we think it's so important, we're going to talk a little bit more about it. But the direction of the fibers are horizontal. They're drawing in of the abdominal wall. They're important with core stabilization, stiffness of the trunk's cylinder, and then we're also getting some SI joint compression and stabilization. Multifidus presents throughout the lumbar spine. It's most prominent down in the lumbar region. Its function is stabilization against rotation of the spine toward the opposite side. So it works opposite of the psoas for the lumbo-pelvic sagittal plane. So here we can see a picture, a diagram, and anatomy of it. See how much it's much more involved down in the lumbar spine. Tonically active during walking and any anti-gravity activities for the upper and lower extremity. It's responsible for more than two-thirds of the segmental stiffness in the L4, L5 level. And Wilkie and different authors here have talked about that it's a stabilizer rather than a prime mover, the multifidi. As you can see, it's a very deep muscle to the spine. So again, some intervention considerations. Proximal stability for distal mobility, it's not a new concept. By using the core stabilizers, we can completely rehabilitate upper and lower extremities and return to optimal function, increase force and torque distally by using the kinetic chain, increase power accuracy of the upper extremity to transverse energy, and then hopefully enhance performance. So some of the way we kind of go about this core training, we begin with the local focus to train the core stabilizing muscles like we talked about, then add larger global muscles to develop power, dynamic function, and allow movement. Work them in different positions, work them in different developmental sequences. So maybe you start them in quadruped, maybe you start them in supine, whatever they can get comfortable with, we start there and then we build upon that as we build their rehab program. And then progress to more unstable surfaces. So maybe they're using a Bosu ball or they're using a Swiss ball. I always tell patients, you know, we like using a Swiss ball a lot here because I always tell athletes that it's now putting you on a state of disaster, which is what happens in sports, right? You know, rarely do you move in a single plane or rarely do you perform your sport laying on your back, unless you're a bad wrestler, I guess. Then you spend time on your back. But you know, trying to take that spine and work it in different areas that they have to work some of those small muscles and work in the core without having to think about it. So that Swiss ball definitely puts them on a state of disaster. And then progressing to weights or resisted bands for the rehab program. So again, work in supine, quadruped, Swiss ball, prone planks, side planks, half kneeling chops and lifts, either using with a medicine ball, TheraBand, dumbbells. Again, closed chain, single leg deadlift, core stability with closed chain with external rotation. So again, I think there's endless possibilities, especially when you got a high school or a college or a middle school athlete trying new things to see what they can do to improve their core muscles. Again, it's only limited by your creativity. Look for the science of the movement based on their sport. Make the exercise functional. And then remember the said principle when you're talking about strengthening. So again, it's why do we work on the core? Because it's evidence-based. See the big picture, treat via the entire kinetic chain. Every athlete should be training their core, prevents re-injury, effectively retraining sport movements to use the core and proximal stabilizers efficiently. Again, trying to focus on training the gut and the butt. So in summary, evaluation is the key to treating the lumbar spine. Decide which of the four categories your athlete or patient fits in the best. Manual therapy and therapeutic exercise appears to be the best scenario for that patient. Focus on core stabilization training. That goes without saying. Functional progression. Work on more static positions and then work that athlete into more dynamic positions that will challenge, again, their core and their other musculatures. And then it can work from simple to more complex activities. Thank you. Thank you.